come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a city, spend a year there, buy and sell, and make a profit. Whereas you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if it's the Lord's will, we shall live and do this or that. But now you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. Therefore, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it's sin. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we're here to give you thanks and glory. Hide this preacher behind the cross. Let it be you that is seen. Let it be your word that is heard, and only your word. And we just give you thanks and glory in Jesus' name. And we all say amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. In these first few verses that we just read today, James paints a picture of a man who thought he had the whole world in his hand. He thought he had the world in the palm of his hand. He was a man that didn't have time for God, not doing the things of God, not looking towards God, didn't want anything to do with God. He thought he had all the time in the world. He had no time for God. But he failed to realize that one day God would have no time for him. Amen. This man thought he had his act together. He had his future all figured out. He had the whole year ahead of him laid out. He had mapped out what was going to happen tomorrow and what was going to happen the days after that. In his mind's eye, he already had the whole year of his life totally planned out. Amen. Do you have 2017 all planned out, brothers and sisters? Do you know what you're going to do? Do you have a map? And the question I want to ask you, is that plan your plan? Or is that plan God's plan? Amen. This man thought he knew where he was going to go in this next year. He says in verse 13, come now, you who say, today and tomorrow we will go to such and such a city, spend a year there, buy and sell, and make a profit. This man was so sure of what was going to happen today and tomorrow, as if the future events were in his power or in his control, as if his health and his life were guaranteed for the rest of the year. This man didn't consult with God in any of this. He had no idea whether he would live today or be alive tomorrow, much less the rest of the year. Amen?
Amen.
He just presumed that he had all the time guaranteed, that he had the whole year figured out and it was guaranteed, and this is what we're going to do, and that's where we're going to go, and this is what we're going to make. Amen? He thought he knew where he was going. He thought he knew where he was going. He said, we will go to such and such a city and do great things. Amen. He had his plans. He looked over the best maps. He analyzed the best routes. He had decided which city to go and which city would be the best city to do his work and conduct his business. Now he just presumed that nothing would happen to him along the way. He thought it was guaranteed. He thought he knew when he was going, where he was going, and he thought he knew who was going with him. He said, we will go to such and such a city. He fully intended on taking his business partner along with him. He just presumed that both of them, him and his partner, would be alive a year from now. Amen. He thought he knew that he was going to go, and he said, we will go to such and such a city, spend the whole year there, buy and sell, and make money. Amen. He had his financial forecast down to a T. But again, he just assumed that the whole year, what business would be good. Amen. He thought he knew where he was going, how he was going, who was going with him. And he would make piles and piles of money. Amen. We all think that's a good plan. Amen. Now, there was something wrong with him making these plans. The thing that was wrong with making these plans is that he didn't ask God about it. He didn't include God. Amen. Now, in the Bible, there's nothing wrong with making piles and piles of money. Making money and making a lot of it is not a sin. The Bible says that God delights in the prosperity of his people. Many of the people of God in the Old Testament were rich, mega rich. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, King Solomon, the richest man of all, wisest man. So money wasn't the problem. Making big money is not a sin. This man's sin was that he made big plans and mapped out his future, but wasn't interested in what God thought about it. You do that. We do that sometimes. We plan stuff out for this year. This year, summer, I'm going to go to California and see my family. Maybe in winter, I'll go to Mexico. Maybe I'll do this. Maybe I'll buy that. And that's okay. But when you don't ask God, or when you don't involve God, then it's not guaranteed. Amen? Amen. This man's sin was that he was not interested in the things of God. His sin was that he planned his life without including God, without consulting with God. He just said, I'm going to do this and this and that. I'm going to go here and go there, all arrogant. Amen? I look through the Bible, brothers and sisters, and I find places where people expected to do great things in the future, but their hopes and dreams were cut short. Amen. Luke 12:16 through 20. Says this. Says, then he spoke a parable, saying, the ground of a certain rich man yielded plentiful. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do, since I have no room to store my crops? So he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build greater ones. And there I will store all my crops and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for yourself for many years. Take ease and eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Then who will those things be which you provide for yourself? So this man is making big plans. I'm going to do this. I got all these treasures. I ain't got no room for them. I'm going to build a bigger barn. And then after it's all stocked up and I collect all this money for me, so when I get old, I can relax, take it easy. I got enough stash in my stash box to last me the whole my rest of my life. I'm just going to relax. And then I'm going to tell my soul, hey, relax, soul, and just take it easy. You got plenty laid up for yourself. And then God says that he was a fool because his life was required that night. And all the stuff he had laid up for himself, who was it going to go to? Amen. We leave that stuff to our kids, but our kids don't love that stuff as much as we love it. We work hard for that. And we earned it, and we do this, and then we leave it to our kids, and our kids will just go pawn it off. They don't love it. They didn't work for it. They got it free. So it's a gift. All right, I'll just go sell it. Stuff that we treasure, our little secret things that we have as personal, they just go sell it. Ain't no big deal to them. And we think that we're going to have this stuff when we're old. But you know, life is short, the Bible says. We might not even be around. And yet we leave God out, and we just make our plans through the year and don't include God, like we're going to be, like we're guaranteed this life for the rest of the year. Amen. The man in this parable died before he could execute all his plans. Psalms 37:35 says, I have seen the wicked in great power, and and spreading themselves like a native tree. Yet he passes away, and behold, he was no more. Indeed, I sought him, but he could not be found. Amen?
Yeah.
It is good to have goals. It's good to have plans. But don't leave God out of them.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
There's no point in making future plans as though God does not exist, because the future all belongs to him. He holds this next year in his hand. And where if you go out there making plans without him, it ain't guaranteed. Amen? That's right. This man was making great plans for the future, boasting about tomorrow. He was forgetting one thing, that he can't control the future. Not one little piece of it he can't control. Only God controls it. You can plan what you will, but you can't bring any of it to pass. Amen. There is not one single thing of this next year that is in your control. You are totally helpless when it comes to changing anything that's going to happen in this future. Amen?
Amen.
We can't control the future. Not even the smallest portion of it is in your ability to control or to change. Amen. A man who boasts about what he's going to do without first consulting God is a darn fool. Amen. Straight out, man. You live your life this year, and without consulting God, it's going to be the same as it was last year. Amen. At the end of the year, you're still where you were. You spun your wheels, you worked hard, and you're still in the same place. Amen. And that's what will happen this year when you plan, have a plan. You know, we have to plan, we have to see what the future brings and what it's going to look like. The key thing is you have to include God.
Amen.
And as soon as God says, no, we're going this way,
amen,
then your plans gets forfeited and you go do what God says to.
Right.
We just kind of have a layout of a map of where we're going. But at any moment, you got to understand that when God says go left, this plan is shot.
Right.
What I plan has got to move aside,
amen,
unless God do all. But as soon as God says, now I'm going this way, then you're like, forget that, but I'm going with God.
Amen.
Amen. And he's got the better road for you. He's got your future all planned out. Amen.
Amen.
Verse 16 says, but now you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. James says that all boasting is evil. Here's a man who simply didn't care about the will of God. He didn't care what God thought. He didn't care what God might want. Never entered his mind or his plans. God was left out of all his decisions, all his plan making. Amen?
Amen.
This man had planned the next year when God said that he couldn't even be sure of tomorrow. Verse 14 says, whereas you do not even know what will happen tomorrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Life is short. You have just a short time to live. Even if you live to be 125, it would still be short. On your way there, it looks like it's long. But once you're there, it's like, man, now I look back, I'm almost hit 50, which I ain't really that old, but they went by fast. When I was a teenager, people that were 25 would be like, you guys are old. You guys are old. And now it's like, no, no, we're not. 40, 47 ain't old. 50 ain't old. Amen. You got a different view when it's all gone. See, when you look back, that's how fast it went. And that's when you get to the end of your life, it's going to be like, man, that's it? I'm done? Oh, man, yeah. Then we'd be looking at God, amen. Bible says that life is fragile, that life is fleeting, that life is just a vapor that appears for a minute and then vanishes away, never to come back. 1 Chronicles 2:29-15 says, our days on earth are as a shadow. Job 7:7, my life is a breath. Psalms 102:11, my days are like a shadow that lengthens, and I wither away like grass. Life is too short, brothers and sisters, to be making plans without God.
Amen.
That's the bottom line. Verse 15 says, instead, you ought to say, if the Lord willing, we shall live and do this or that. Amen? We can't do nothing about the future. The future in God is in God's hands. God is absolutely in control of every situation. We serve an almighty and all-powerful God who not only knows about the future, but he controls it. And he authors it for you. Amen? We need to yield our will to God of our lives and submit our future to his plans. And his plans are good. Amen? Amen. We need to make our plans around the word of God, in God, in the center of our hearts, and ask him in every decision, in every situation. Sometimes we decide without going to God. Sometimes we make decisions and choices without even asking God. We get in trouble, we get into something, we're like, well, I'm going to do this. That guy rose against me, well, I'm going to knock him out. See, we make a decision before we think about it. When somebody comes against me, we got to say, Lord, what do I do? What do I do? I want to knock him out, but what do I do? See, when your finances are low, okay, I got to go rob a bank. See, if you make your own decision, it'll be just like that. You got to take it to God. Lord, I need my finances are low. What do I do, Lord? Open to see what he's got. His treasure got more money than anywhere else. So why am I going to search other places? When it's all in the hands of God. So I got to go where all the power's at. Where all the wealth is at. Where all the prosperity is at. Where all the healing's at. Amen? That's right. Lord willing, we will do this or that. Lord willing, we will go here or there. Life is more than everything just working out the way I want it. Life is about everything working out the way God has planned it. Amen? That's right. God has a great plan for you. His plan ain't to hurt you. His plan is to prosper you. And Jeremiah 29:11 says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a good future. That's what God's plan is for you. And we go on our own way. We find other plans. 12-step prosperity plans. You know what I mean? 12 abs in 5 seconds. 8-minute abs. You know, we try to go the easy way. And all these formulas and stuff. When you can just go to God, he has the best plan. Amen. That's right. That's right. God has a great plan. God knows the future. God's plan for you is good. And then there's hope there. We just got to give him a chance. Sometimes we ask God, God, help me in whatever situation I'm in. And if he don't pop it up right now, then okay, he's not real. We'll do it on our own. Give him some time. Give him some space. Pray to God and then wait on him. Give him some time. Give him some room to work. Everything's working out. The Bible says that when you pray, the angel of the Lord, he's taking that prayer to heaven to God. But on the way, he's fighting demons and stuff. He's fighting the hell's angels on his way to take that message to God. So on the way, we don't even wait. The angel's barely taking off and he started to ascend into heaven to go tell God your prayer. And he's fighting and wrestling and you're like, you can't wait. You want it now. So by the time it's done, by the time it gets to a place for a while, we couldn't wait on the Lord. We want the Lord to wait on us. We have to wait on the Lord. Amen? Amen. Give him time. Every child of God here this morning needs to know that God has a plan for you, and he's in control of that plan, and he wants to help every area of your life. Amen? Amen. Sometimes he allows stuff to happen in your life. Sometimes it puts you on time out and you don't even know why. Amen? Because we're so busy with our lives. We're so busy doing our thing and what I need to get for my house and what I need to do for my family and me for no more. Amen? And we don't give God any room to play. And then when we're in trouble, we're like, oh Lord. Oh Lord. It's like when you were doing good, you didn't come seek after me. When you were getting blessed, you didn't bless me back. And now that you need something from the Lord, now we're, Lord, Lord, help me. Help me, Lord. Amen. And then we want him to do it now. He's like, you want me to do it for you, but what about when I called you to do something? What about when I called you to serve me? How about when I called you to wait on me? How about that? And now you get mad when I don't listen to you. A lot of times we feel abandoned by the Lord. You're like, well, I accepted Christ the way the Bible says. What did I do? Lose my salvation? No. It feels like it, though. It does. It feels like God has abandoned you because we're not walking and doing the things of the Lord. So he has to sit us on time out so we can reflect on what's going on. Amen. And it feels like God has left me. But no, he just chastising you. He's squeezing you, making you look up. If God never gave you any problems, if God never put you in a storm, you would never look to God. In the storm is where God is. In that trouble you're going through, that's where you're going to find God. So if you're in a storm right now, you got some issues going on, praise the Lord, you're going to see God. He's been walking on the storm of the disciples. They're about to go down in the storm. And Jesus, where did he come? Right on the water. That's the time you're going to see God. Because that's the time you're going to be looking up. When we're partying, having things, nice trucks, nice cars, nice food. We're like, I don't need God. I can get it myself. I worked all week. I just go buy it. I need a car. I'll go buy it. I need food. I'll go buy it. King Falafels. Amen. Y'all, that's California. It's a next person if you're ever there. But anyway, sometimes we're in a storm and we think we're going down. But God says that all things work out together for those who love God. So even in the storm, you feel like you're abandoned, God is there. All those things are going to work out if you just seek God and look to God, and you'll wind up in a better position. Amen. But you just got to wait. You just got to wait. You got to keep going. You don't say, hey, Lord, do this for me, and then go about your business. No, every day you got to say, Lord, I know you're going to come through. Lord, I know you're going to do it. I can't see it right now. I don't know what you're doing up there, Lord, but I know you're in charge, and I know you're going to come through. You're going to do it. Amen? That's right. So do you love Jesus this morning? That he's working it all out for your good, to use it for a greater purpose, to bring you to a higher level. Verse 16 says, But now you boast in your arrogance, and all such boasting is evil. To boast and to brag, you know, it's evil. 2 Corinthians 10:17 says, but let him who boasts, boast in the Lord. Amen. Amen. So when you're out driving your nice truck, look what I got. Look what I got. Look at my house. I bought this. Look at my girl. I picked her out. Look at my clothes. I did this. God says, man, you know where that comes from? You know where that comes from? Then you're boasting like you did something. Like, well, I went and did the hours at work. Well, who gave me the breath to get up in the morning and go to the hall? Who runs the show? Who guys control the air of your life, of everything, your health? If it wasn't for God, you wouldn't be healthy enough to get up in the morning. If it wasn't for God, you wouldn't be green. If it wasn't for God, you know, he gave you the ability to make wealth, the Bible says. God gives you that ability for you to go out and make that money. And see, when you boast about it and say, I did this. If you were morning, I did it. If you were like me, you would do it. See, when you boast. And God says, no, it all comes from me. God does it. You can boast unto the Lord all day long, and it's not a sin. Look what the Lord's done. The Lord has done great things in my life. He's given me the ability to make wealth. He's given me the breath I breathe. He's my strong tower. He's my protection. He's my rock. He's my salvation. He'll never leave me. This year is going to be great because the Lord is with me. That's the whole thing of the Lord. Amen? That's right. That's right. Verse 17 says, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him is sin. We all know that doing wrong is sin. But James tells us that sin is also not doing what's right. People say, well, I don't sin no more, I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't. But do you do everything right? Do you do everything that you're supposed to? Do you take every opportunity that God has given you to do it? Or do we like, I don't know, Lord, I don't know about that one. And then we let it pass by. We take too long and the moment passes. Amen? When you refuse to do what is right, when you refuse to work for the Lord and serve Him and plan instead for your own work in the future, God says that's a sin. That's a hard one to swallow, amen? But it's a sin, man. If you know what's right and don't do it, it's a sin. You know it's right this morning to put God first. And you don't do it, it's a sin. You know it's right for you to consult with God in every situation. When you don't do what's right, that's sin. You know that it's right to count on Him for your direction. When you don't do it, that's a sin. When you don't look to God for every decision you make, that's the right thing to do. If you don't do it, that's a sin. Amen. It's right for you to include God in the future. And when you don't, that's a sin. That's how easy it is. All these things are right to do. And when you don't do the right thing, that's also a sin. When people say, I don't do it, so I'm perfect. Amen. We all have issues. I have problems with that. Sometimes my mouth speaks. I'm going to go do this. Then I catch myself later. God hits me on the 2x4 in the head and says, you're going to do what? I didn't hear about that. It's like, oh, Lord, well, if you let it happen, Lord, you know. And I have to take it back. To him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him is sin. The day to do something for the Lord is today. Start today. Tomorrow it might never come. Today is all you have, the Bible says. He says today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of grace. Today is the day of mercy. Today is the day to serve God. Amen. I heard someone say this, and you've heard it before. Yesterday is a canceled check. Gone forever. Tomorrow is a promissory note. It may never be redeemed. Today is cash in hand. Spend it wisely.
Amen.
Today is cash in hand. There's only two things you can do with cash. You can spend it, waste it, or you can invest it. And I'm not talking about money. It's just for instance, like your life. Your life today, this day today, is like cash. You can waste this day, or you can invest it. And the way you waste it is just doing whatever you want to do without God. And the way you invest it is doing what God said do. Because that's the only profit you're going to get, is when you do the things for the Lord, bring profit. Everything else, there's no profit under the sun. Only the things you do in Christ, in the Lord, for the Lord, around the Lord. And it ain't about being all religious, so don't be scared. It's like, what? I have to do all these things? No. In your heart. Every day, be aware that God is who He says He is. In the morning, acknowledge Him. Just by simply saying, Lord, I know You're there. And I know You're with me today. And I'm going to go to work. And I know You're going to control this day. Go to work, and in your mind, something good happened. Oh, thank you, Lord. I know this is You. When something bad is going on, it's like, Lord, I know You're going to intervene. Because You're my Lord. You're all powerful. I know You love me. You ain't going to let me fall, slip, or fail. It's all on You. And then you, in the Lord. That's as simple as it is. You can just add Lord to it and mean it, and it'll change everything. It'll change the direction. And I guarantee by the end of the year, this year, in Christ, you'll be in a higher plane. You'll be in a better position. God will answer your prayer. Whatever it is, something you lost, something you love, He will give it back to you. He'll restore you. The Bible says He'll restore what the devil stole from you. Amen. And the devil steals all the time and kills and destroys. He wants to steal your peace of mind. He wants to destroy your family. He wants to just do all kinds of stuff to you. Amen? He wants to kill, steal, and destroy. But the Lord wants to bless you. You to flourish. And you to be prosperous. But only if you do it His way. And you know what his way is, right? Jesus. His way is Jesus. I want you to try it. I don't want you to believe me and take my word for it. I want you to just try it this year. Begin by praising God. You've already started. By being here today, you're putting God first.
Amen.
The first day of the year, the first day of the week. Amen. So you're starting off good. And God is amazing, man. He just wants to make sure that when he blesses you, it's going to be for his kingdom glory. If he's going to bless me and I'm going to go do what I want, he ain't interested in that. Lord, I want this so I can do. I ain't interested in that. Lord, I want to do this to give you glory. Now, I'm interested in that, God says. If you're going to give me glory, then I'm all in. But if you're going to do it for your own pleasures, then count me out. But if you're going to do it for me, God says, and it's all to show his goodness, it's the same thing you're doing now, no different, except you're adding God to it. The same way the things that you're doing now, going to work and back and eating and drinking and being married, same exact thing, but now you're adding God in the midst of all that. And trust me, man, it'll make a difference. It definitely will. And a year from now, you're going to come and say, man, God was good.
Amen.
He blessed me this year. You know what, crazy, stupid preacher? You were right. All that stuff you were saying, yeah, you were right. I don't like you much, but you know what? You said the truth. Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
So today we're going to have the Lord's Supper. Oh, Lord, I didn't have nothing today. Probably sounded like nothing. God is good. Amen.
Amen.
All right, so we're going to get the, our ushers up here. Bob, Brother Jim, you know who you are. All right. Okay, we'll give our kids a couple seconds to be here. Then he gave it to his disciples. Bible says that at the cross, one of the soldiers pierced his side with the spear, and immediately blood and water came out. Pouring out his blood, isn't it? Take this drink. This is the blood which is shed for you. Then Jesus said to them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not the bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he which comes down from heaven and giveth life unto the world." Then he said they unto him, "Lord, evermore give us this bread." And Jesus said unto them, "I am the bread of life. He that comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes shall never thirst." Then he said, Jesus said unto them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, ye have no life in you. Whosoever eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwells in me, and I in him." And when he says, "Take, eat of my, drink of my blood and eat of my flesh," he's not talking about physical. It means take him in, like if you were eating food, take him in as if you were taking drink, and let it go inside you. Amen? Eat this word, eat this bread, drink his blood. That's what we're doing in remembrance of him. Amen. Let's pray again. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you for your blood and for your body that you put out for us. We understand that this is what it's all about, and today we remember you. In Jesus' name, amen. Before music starts, anybody have any prayers?